Our writer here at Healthcare Triage, Tiffany, used to work in a lab focused on obesity. And the professor running the lab used to love talking about addressing obesity by engineering the environment. So what exactly does that mean? And does it actually work? That's the topic of this week's Healthcare Triage. Okay, so what does engineering the environment actually mean in the context of today's episode? It essentially means making changes to our surroundings to change our behavior, and more specifically, behaviors with a potential impact on obesity. This can apply in any environment, including your work, your home, and even the route you take to get places. But in this episode, we're going to narrow down to one example, the grocery store checkout. We've all been there. Waiting in line to make a purchase while racks of candy bars stare us in the face and little fridges full of sugary beverages beckon us to open them. Are all the options bad? Well, no, but somewhere around 70% of the options found at checkouts are considered unhealthy. Are we tempted by this? Absolutely. One 2021 study found that more than 1 in 3 U.S. adults reported making a purchase of these items while waiting to check out at their last grocery store excursion. And more than half of U.S. adults reported making such a purchase at the checkout within the prior month. It's called impulse marketing, a promotional strategy to increase sales via spur-of-the-moment purchases. And it is quite successful. Intentional placement of product in this manner significantly increases sales. Another example is placement on end caps, or those little spots at the end of each aisle where you usually see things like bags of chips and cases of soda. Somewhere around 30% of grocery store sales are of items placed on these so-called end caps. And even though most of us probably feel immune to these tactics, especially if we specifically know about them, I've got bad news. We are definitely not immune. Anecdotally, I'm prone to corn nuts, which are so crunchy and so delicious. However, quite a lot of data exists about how heavily our purchasing behaviors are influenced by things like product placement and display characteristics. Marketing companies research this stuff to death, even using eye tracking technology to make sure their product displays drag our eyeballs right where they want them. And even if we're really trying to make good choices, cognitive neuroscience tells us that we have a harder time doing that if we're stressed, distracted, in a hurry, or have already made a bunch of decisions. All things that easily become true at the end of a post-work grocery store trip. You finally make it up to the checkout, and there's that refreshing Coke, signaling your tired mind to treat yourself as you wait in line. You've used up all your cognitive reserves, navigating a busy grocery store, deciding on dinners and ingredients, resisting the urge to buy cookies, and rushing to get home in time. You'll probably grab that Coke. So if we change the products offered on end caps and checkouts, will we change behavior? Or are people going to seek out that Coke regardless of where it is in the store? Evidence suggests we can change. A 2018 study conducted in the UK compared supermarkets that had implemented a healthy checkout food policy to those that had not. Examination of less healthy purchases 1 year before and 1 year after implementation of the policy revealed a 17.3% reduction in purchases of those items. Further, that decrease was mostly sustained even a year later. Same paper reported a smaller study where approximately 7,500 people recorded the food they bought at supermarkets to eat on the go, things regularly found in checkout lines like small packages of cookies and chips. After checkout food policies were implemented, purchases of these items fell by around 76%. These were, of course, self-reported data, which can be seriously flawed, but that's a whopping number that is worth further investigation. Before you get too excited, keep in mind that these data don't address whether these changes have a measurable impact on obesity or on various health metrics, and getting good data to answer that question would be tough. And even if we did, making these kinds of changes wouldn't be easy either, mainly due to concerns over things like impact on businesses and making food placement policies mandatory. Does that mean we shouldn't bother to get more data on this? Absolutely not. We should always get more data. Hey, if you enjoyed this episode, you might enjoy this other episode on research that doesn't work, even though they said it did, to prevent obesity. We would like it if you'd subscribe to the channel, like the video down below, maybe go to patreon.com/healthcaretriage where you can help support the show, make it bigger and better. We'd especially like to thank our research associates, Edward Lilyaholm, Joshua Crow, and of course, our surgeon admiral, Sam.